Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you're having a blessed and peaceful Sabbath day. Now, today's lesson is titled, Your Test in Life, Part 1. Hopefully I get to Part 2, or maybe even 3. But for today, we're going to be talking about temptations and trials, and I'm going to be reading out of the book of James, starting with chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, and it reads like this. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, but let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Look, we all live a life that's filled with tests. We refer to them as trials, problems, temptations, and so forth. The point is that we pass them or fail them when they come about. The main thing that we need to consider is that all combined, they factor into the outcome of our salvation. And the first point of contention that you need to understand is that you have to be a believer for this to even matter. So if you're not a believer, it doesn't even matter because you're going to be off doing your own thing. Now, maybe as a believer, you're failing just miserably in this test of life with weak faith, not trusting in the Father and His Word, which causes you to stay in sin and whatever. But this is dangerous ground to be on because you never know when your end is going to come, and you don't even know when He's going to come for that matter. But look, understand that the Father does have tests, examinations, and we're all going to have to learn how to make a passing grade, and it would behoove us all to strive for an A+. So first we're going to talk about the fact of temptation. Remember, we're talking about testing. The word testing and the word temptation are used interchangeably, so remember that as we move forward. But first of all, I want you to notice the fact of temptation. Now, notice in verse 1, James reads, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. Now, when James says to the 12 tribes, he's not talking literally. He's talking figuratively in the sense that he's comparing the New Testament to the Old Testament saints. He's comparing the church of Israel and Judah. Now, just as Israel and Judah had been dispersed or separated from their friends and from their country, Israel and Judah suffered being a conquered people under the oppression of cruel leaders. And here, James is using this as an example, as a figure of speech, to describe and delineate the church or create a picture of the people even today. So when he says to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, he's speaking to believers everywhere. He's speaking to you if you're a believer. He's speaking to this person if they're a believer. This message is to believers everywhere, wherever, whoever suffer trials and temptations and tribulation. This is the Father's word to you. But you say, well, I'm not scattered abroad. Well, really, this world is not our home. We're just passing through and we shouldn't get comfortable here. The Father doesn't want us to settle down here. We have heaven that we should be looking forward to. Now, all of us are going to go through difficulties. Understand this. But notice in verse 2, it reads, my brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptations. And not if ye fall into divers temptations, because when you do, and you will, whether you're a believer or not, it doesn't matter if you're saved or lost, you will run into difficulty in this life. It doesn't matter who you are. There are going to be trials. There will be oppression, misunderstanding, and rejection. It makes no difference if you're a believer. Your belief will not make you immune. All people fall into diverse trials and temptations, or diverse trials and temptations. Now, to have the belief that when you become a believer that it's going to be smooth sailing from that point on and that you're not going to have any troubles or difficulties is just really naive thinking and a lack of understanding. So never let the notion consume you. We must be prepared. Persecution, trial, and testing are part of life. It's unavoidable and it's universal. It's inevitable, as was pointed out in verses 1 and 2. Now, secondly, we need to understand the forms of temptation. So let's talk about these couple of forms of temptation. Notice in verse 2, again, it reads, my brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptations. Now, The word divers means various kinds, sundry, miscellaneous temptations. So my trials and tests may not be like yours, and yours may not be like mine, because there are many, they're diverse, they're varied, and they come in two different categories, but they don't necessarily have to be the same. Now, the first is the testing of our faith. The word testing and trials may mean just simply a test, like you test something to see if it works properly or if it's worthy, like you would do with medicine or, say, a car that you want to purchase. Now, Peter 1, verse 4 reads, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened unto you." And verse 7 reads like this, "That trial of your faith being much more precious than of gold that perish, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ." Now, it's used as fire is used to test metal to prove whether it's pure or not, or whether it's an alloy. Proverbs 25:4 reads like this, it says, "Take away the dross from thy silver, and there shall come forth a vessel for the finer." So, simply put, fire separates the junk from the metal and leaves the good shiny stuff that people love and like. This is why the phrase "tried by the fire" or "in the fire" is used. The one kind of testing that is sent by the Father to cause you to stand or fail if you choose to do so in your weakness. Now, the second testing is the temptation by the devil. Now, here's another kind of temptation or another kind of testing, and this is sent by the enemy. Be very clear and understand that the word temptation is not only used as a sense of a trial or test, but it is also used as a solicitation to evil, as in tempting someone to sin. Now, this is not sent by the Father. James 1 tells us, starting with verse 13, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away from his own lust and enticed. Then, when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death." So, don't ever accuse the Father of tempting you to sin. This is exclusive work of the devil. And the difference between the two is this. Trials are sent by the Father to cause you to stand. Temptation to sin is sent by the devil to cause you to stumble. One is meant for our maturity, the other is meant for misery and destruction. Simple and clear. Both simply totally different. You can't confuse the two. Now, James uses both words interchangeably, as most people are prone to do so. When he says temptations, understand that he can mean either, as we're going to see as we go farther on. Now, while the Father does not cause both kinds, he allows both kinds to fulfill his will. So whether it is a testing of our faith or tempting to sin, both are used. Understand that. Don't be confused. So always understand that these are the forms of temptation, as we like to call them all, and we're going to face them. Now, the third thing we need to understand is the force of temptation. Now, let's talk about the force of these different temptations. Notice again in verse 2, James says, "My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into diverse temptations." Now, just look at the word "fall into," because that's the way they come. We fall into them. Now, Luke 30 shows us like this. It reads, "And Jesus answered, saying, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him for dead." Now, here's a man just going along. He feels fine, minding his own business, and suddenly, just like that, he's in trouble. See, some of you aren't paying a lot of attention right now to what's going on in your life, and you're comfortable and you think everything's fine. Having a fine day, I got a woman, I got a man, good job, blood pressure down, bank account up, everything's fine. But maybe that's just for the next 5 minutes, or the next hour, or the next day. But if you're not paying attention, when diverse temptation come, or when a diverse temptation come or falls upon you suddenly, then what? If you're not prepared, you're going to have major problems. See, you don't know what the next phone call is going to bring. You don't know what you're going to meet when you walk out your door or when you get in your car. You just don't know. It always seems, or it may just seem, that everything's fine right now, but what the word is telling us, that when it talks about falling into diverse temptations or diverse temptations, it says when they come, they may come savagely, they may be serious, they may be sudden, and you don't know, and I don't know when they're going to come. That's the sense of what fall into diverse temptations mean. We are clueless, but we have to be prepared. Now, here's a sad story recently out of the news, which conveys exactly what I'm trying to teach. But don't focus on the notion that this whole situation was viewed upon and driven as a race-related situation, because the bottom line is it ends up not mattering. But in this country, it's a very easy and simple thing to do when we're trying to be judgmental and point blame at someone. But it ends up not mattering because tragic situations like this happen. So the fact we need to focus on is that this speaks directly to the suddenness of how lives can be changed or extinguished instantly and savagely. Diverse temptations or diverse temptations. Now, you could be just like the man who fell among thieves, or you could be the 55-year-old man named Theodore Wafer who was asleep minding his own business and was awakened by 19-year-old Renisha McBride knocking on his door in the middle of the night because she had just crashed her vehicle that she was driving. Now here are two people who suddenly are going through trials. Now this young lady who was drunk and driving crashed her vehicle and stumbled to the door of Mr. Wafer. Now he was awakened by her knocking at the door in the middle of the night, and now suddenly he's fallen into a diverse temptation. See, their trials may be different from yours and mine, but we have to understand what forces may or may not be working here. Now, let's look at some simple facts. The enemy tempted her, first of all, to drink and then to drive. She gave into those temptations, which ended up with her having an accident and then knocking on this man's door. Now, for whatever his weaknesses were, even if it was fear-driven, which we know is not of the Father, it's directly from the enemy, that fear drove him to go to his door, but in the process, pick up a gun and take it with him. Now, the enemy tempted him also to fire that weapon through the door, which he did, killing the young lady. Now, you have people in serious situations here. You have a deceased young woman whose life is over, and now you have a 55-year-old man who has been convicted of murder and faces life in prison. Now, the facts of these stories don't give matter to whether or who was right or wrong. It doesn't matter. The situation as a whole is tragic. But the point is to look at how quickly two separate individuals who just hours before thought everything is fine, neither one of them nor their families woke up that previous morning thinking that they needed to be prepared for something like that to appear on their doorstep the next morning. But see, this could easily be you or I under different circumstances, which illustrate the simpleness of and diverseness of trials and temptations. And the enemy is always at the ready to cause them. Look, we must always be ready every moment for anything possible that the enemy can hurl against us at his selected moment. See, it's when he's ready, not when we're ready, but we have to be prepared so we are ready. He is always seeking to destroy and devour us, even if it's a little bit at a time. You know, he goes a little bit along and then boom, got you. So think about this, how this situation culminated. It went, have a drink, have two or three. Now you're drunk. It's okay, you can drive, crash, knock on the door, knock on that door. Who's at my door? It's one of them. You better get them before they get you. Go ahead, shoot, they're gonna get you. Bam, and now you have it. When you look at it in its simpleness, it's all quick. It happens suddenly and quick, but it's culminated in all this tragedy. So don't ever think that you are slicker than the enemy. It's not the little things that and how they start out, is how they end up. See, a bunch of little things starting out can end up in something serious and major. The force of temptation when it comes will be sudden, swift, most surely, and maybe even savagely when it comes. It may just come out of control. You never know. And that's what too many people are looking for. They're looking for something major and savage that they can get a handle on before it happens, but it doesn't always happen like that. It always starts out with little things and works itself up, and then it culminates into something huge. And then you're going, how did we get here? It's amazing that a seemingly innocuous thing like having a drink could end up in murder and a life sentence in prison. It just doesn't make sense when you look at it that simplistically, but that's all it takes. All it takes is to add a couple simple things, some bad judgment, mix in some fear, and then finally you have the enemy prodding and cheering you on to do the wrong thing, and you end up with all this. Don't ever sleep on the enemy, and don't miss being ready for the Father like the foolish virgins. See, because Matthew 25:5, it reads, it says, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. It's the same difference. We have to be prepared for whatever, because if we're sitting around just focusing on the Father, we're not worrying about the devil. If we're just sitting around worrying about the devil, we're not focusing on the Father. We have to be prepared for everything. And remember, temptation is not going to be removed by conversion, and it's not going to be lessened by consecration. Never hold on to the idea that if you are saved, you won't face any of those old temptations. Who are you kidding? I mean, the enemy's just going to try them much harder. You don't learn that from the word of the Father. He doesn't teach us that in the word, that these things aren't going to happen. And the devil will try and make them happen more forcibly, because he doesn't want us to think about the Father. He wants us to just stay in sin. So, trials are still going to come. Job 14:1 reads, man that is born of woman is of a few days and full of trouble. We're going to have trouble. So it doesn't matter whether you're saved or whether you're not. There's just a difference in what believers have to do with their problems than what the unsaved person doesn't have to do with his. Understand that. It's a simple matter. Be prepared. This is Brother Lloyd. I'll be back with part 2. I'm out.